so I think we'll begin. Hi, my name is Joey, and I'm a member of the Student Advisory Board here at the Dole Institute. And I'd like to welcome you, and thank you for attending today's program. The Dole Student Advisory Board is composed of KU students committed to the work of the Dole Institute. We attend regular meetings, assist in events just like this one, and plan an SAB-sponsored program every semester. Members of the SAB receive great opportunities to network with our special guests. If you are a student and would like to join, please contact the Dole Institute. If you'd like to know more and about supporting the SAB and other Dole Institute activities, please contact our development coordinator, Clarissa Unger. The Dole Institute would like to hear from you. If you enjoy today's program, please let us know by contacting us on Facebook, Twitter, or through our website email. Your attendance and feedback help shape future programming. To view past programs, visit our online video archive at www.doleinstitute.org. A video of today's presentation will be available on our website soon. Before we begin today, I'd like to remind you to please turn off your cell phones, and that after the presentation, we'll have some time for question and answers with the audience. If you have a question, please raise your hand and I will bring you a microphone. Without the microphone, you cannot get on our audio for our online video. So it's very important that you have a microphone before you ask your question, please. If at any time during the program you have difficulty hearing, please alert one of our staff members or student volunteers and they can assist. And now a little bit about today's guest speaker. Dr. Ethan Rafuse received his BA and MA degrees in history at George Mason University and his PhD in history and political science at the University of Missouri, Kansas City. He is a former park ranger at Manassa National Battlefield and the Harry S. Truman National Historic Site. From 2001 to 2003, he taught military history at the U.S. Military Academy at West Point, and since 2004 has been a member of the Department of Military History at the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College up at Fort Leavenworth, where he is a professor of history. He has published over 250 articles, essays, and reviews, and is the author, editor, or co-editor of 10 books. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Ethan Rafuse.
Thank you, good afternoon. It's good to see so many people here coming here for a non-American military history subject. How many of you, were any of you at the program last summer that we did on the Gettys, 3 days at Gettysburg? Okay, well, a couple people here. I know you were, because you were part of it, Dr. Beckenbaugh. I do a lot of Civil War programs, and when asked to participate in this Decisive Battle series, I decided I wanted to do something non-Civil War, so I chose the Battle of Koniggratz. Now, my experience in speaking to groups about the Civil War, you almost always get somebody showing up in a reenactor outfit or something like that. And so I'm somewhat disappointed today that I don't see anybody with a spiky helmet or anything like that to signify the Prussian army. I'll get over that, and hopefully we'll have a good talk and a good Q&A at the end. The Battle of Koniggratz was the largest battle of the modern era. Battle of Leipzig in 1813 might have been a little bit bigger prior to World War I, but the Battle of Koniggratz on the 3rd of July, 1866, which was 148 years ago today, 2 years we can come back here, we can celebrate the 150th anniversary of it. And about 440 to 460,000 troops were engaged at Koniggratz, which is far more than at any Civil War battle. Now, the battle marks the end of a rivalry between Austria and Prussia over power in Germany. And this rivalry traced back to the 1740s when Frederick the Great of Prussia invaded Silesia and took it from the Austrian Empire. And from that point forward, tension between Austria and Prussia had sort of been a constant of European power politics. Although the two did work together to help defeat Napoleonic France, in part because the Habsburgs and Hohenzollern dynasties viewed the Republican ideas of Republican France to be hostile to their interests. In 1815, the Napoleonic Wars were ended with the Congress of Vienna. There was an effort by the statesmen of Europe to put
the nationalism genie back in the bottle and to try to establish a stable reconciliation of Europe and to set up a system that would endure and avoid future wars while also preserving the crowned heads of Europe from the threat of nationalism. The key actor at the Congress of Vienna, of course, was the Austrian leader, Prince Metternich, who was their foreign minister. And part of his leadership, the German Confederation was created. The Napoleonic Wars had inspired a sense of nationalism in France, and where French armies went, they inspired nationalism in those areas, and Germany was one of those places that was affected. And coming out of the war, though, there was a concern that a unified Germany would be too strong and too powerful and a threat to the rest of its neighbors. And so consequently, at Vienna, the idea of unified Germany was not on the table. Instead, as a substitute, they created sort of a United Nations of Germany, a German confederation composed of 35 princely states and four free cities. That would meet in a diet, sort of a United Nations at Frankfurt, in which case where the votes would be heavily weighted in favor of Austria and Prussia, with the Austrian emperor being the honorary president of the confederation. And this situation stabilizes Europe, and Europe enjoys 30 years of relative stability, aside from 1830, where you have a Polish uprising, and you have the change in leadership in France. But in 1848, you have the nationalist revolutions, and which begin in France with the abdication of the French king. And this kind of republican spirit, this nationalist spirit, is once again reawakened in Europe and receives stimulus. German liberals see this as an opportunity to push for the creation of a German nation state. But they had a kind of a question in what direction to go. On the one hand, who would lead this new German state? Prussia, with its militaristic reputation, was not viewed very favorably by German liberals, while Austria was viewed, because of all of its nationalities, to be too much of a quote-unquote mongrel state to really provide the leadership that a unified German nation provided. Nonetheless, by the end of 1848, German liberals had come to the conclusion that Prussia would perhaps provide the best leadership to this new German nation, and they offered the crown of the German nation to the Emperor Frederick William IV. Frederick William IV rejects this, and when later asked why he did it, he tells a friend that, quote, he would not accept a crown from the gutter, and disgraced by the stink of revolution, defiled with dirt and mud. The Austrians had a rather troubling experience in 1848. Austria-Hungary, of course, is a polyglot of various nationalities, Hungarians, Croats, Slavs, Slovenians, among the numbers in there. And the nationalist revolutions of 1848 were very troubling for the Austrians. The Habsburgs, Metternich was forced to resign. More liberal ministers who succeeded him couldn't maintain order. But eventually the Czechs do, through counter-revolutionary efforts, defeat Czech and Italian uprisings, and while the Russians help in defeating the Hungarian uprisings of 1848 and 1849. In November of 1850, the Austrians and the Prussians get together and agree that this revolution was not such a good thing, and they decide to reestablish the German Confederation as before. 9 years later, Austria finds itself drawn in another conflict over Italy with France. And France goes to the help of Piedmont, which is the leading state in northern Italy. There's a battle fought at the Battle of Solferino in June of 1859, in which Austrian forces are defeated. And 2 years later, Austria is helpless to do anything when the Kingdom of Italy is created with Victor Emmanuel II of Sardinia as their king. The war also has the effect of leaving Austria very financially exhausted, while at the same time Prussia had been growing wealthy due to the Prussian customs union that had been established and their ability to draw on coal, iron, and the resources of the Ruhr, Saar, and Silesia regions. In 1862, this guy came to charge power in Prussia, Otto von Bismarck. And Otto von Bismarck is a Prussian, he is a royalist, he is a conservative, but he is also a realist. And he recognizes the revolutions of 1848 and 1849 were rooted in a German nationalism that was going to pop up again. And the question was, should Prussia let this nationalism led by South German states and liberal Germans, should they let them drive the unification of Germany that German people want? Or perhaps Prussia can drive this process of unification. Now, again, Bismarck is foremost a Prussian, a conservative, but he recognizes it's in the interest of the Prussian state to take the lead in pushing toward German unification. And he also recognizes the great obstacle to this is going to be Austria. So from almost the moment he ascends to a position of power, he begins maneuvering for a confrontation with Austria in order to settle the issue of Germany. In 1864, the Germans and the Prussians and the Austrians joined together to fight the Danes, the Denmark, in what comes as the Schleswig-Holstein War, a war over a controversy that inspired one person to say that it was so complicated, only three people really knew what the cause of the war, what the issue was. And one person went crazy, one person died, and me, and I forgot. The war is fought to a successful conclusion by Austrian and Prussian forces. They signed what's called the Gastein Convention of August 1865 to establish joint occupancy of Schleswig and Holstein provinces. And Bismarck pushes really hard for a settlement that's more favorable to Prussia and one that will create complications with Austria. And sure enough, it eventually does so. In the aftermath of this war, Bismarck moves diplomatically to isolate Austria. He meets with Napoleon III of France in October 1865. In April 1866, he establishes a military alliance with Italy, which covets Austrian territory in Venetia and in the southern Tyrol. So the maneuvers for this war, Bismarck, almost as soon as the 1864 war is concluded, he is already maneuvering for the next round with Austria. The Austrian army, despite its defeat in 1859, was highly regarded by the armies of Europe. In 1864, its operations in Denmark had gotten a lot of attention, whereas the Prussians had not gotten a great deal. And it was kind of viewed as the Austrian army having recovered from the conflict of 1859 with the French over Italy. But in fact, the war in 1864, just as the war in 1859 had done, left the Austrian crown with significant financial problems. So it really could not afford another war with Prussia, but its army was highly regarded. Its cavalry and its artillery were superior to the Prussians in the 1866 war. It was a conscript force, like many of the countries of Europe. They had conscription, but the Austrians' service in the Austrian army was not universal. They had an extensive list of exemptions for the educated and the professional classes in Austria. They had difficulties in communication in an army composed of various nationalities. And there was always the question of how much Hungarians, Czechs, and Italians in the Austrian-Hungarian army could be trusted, one, to obey orders, two, to understand orders because of all the different languages that were used. In order to avoid the threat of revolution from the nationalities, the Austrian government established a practice of when they had a regiment from a nationality from a certain area, they would station it somewhere else out of concern that they would be infected by locals with nationalism, and that would compromise their loyalty to the Austrian service. But again, this had the effect of detaching these local units from their local home areas, in contrast to Prussia, where the military forces were raised locally, and so they maintained a connection to their local areas, which had significant effect on combat motivation and unit morale, unit cohesion. The officer corps in Austria emphasized courage and devotion to duty, but not really discipline and certainly not serious study of their professions. It was aristocratic and very simple in their approach to tactics. Their preferred infantry tactic was shock tactics with the bayonet, in large part because it was simple enough for an army with so many different nationalities to carry out in so many different languages. A massed assault with the bayonet was the emphasis of the Austrian tactical efforts. They raised about 528,000 troops for the war in 1866 from a population of 35 million. The man they placed in command of it was Ludwig August von Benedict. who was a Hungarian but a Protestant loyal to the crown. Born in 1804, a devoted monarchist and conservative, whose military career he had served with distinction in Italy and in Hungary in 1848 and 1849. And he was one of the few officers to come away from the Battle of Solferino with his reputation actually enhanced, as he had performed very, very well in his part of the battle. And part of his reward afterwards was he was given the prime command assignment in the Austrian army, and that was in command of forces in Italy. So consequently, he would spend many of the years that followed in Italy. And consequently, when there was discussion of appointing him command of the forces that would face Prussia, the fighting which would take place in Bohemia, Benedict was not enthusiastic about this assignment. He figured he knew the Italian theater. He had served in Italy, but Bohemia he wasn't too certain about. Nonetheless, he was popular with the public and he was admired by his troops. But again, he acknowledged that, like many officers, he was not a serious student of warfare. He said, quote, "I know too little," the scientifically arrogant strategist. "I conduct the business of war according to quite simple rules and am no friend of complicated combinations." The Prussian army he's going to face has an officer corps that takes a very different approach to the development of their officers, one that embraced the idea of the scientific strategist. Although Helmut von Moltke, the commander of the Prussian general staff who's going to lead the forces in 1866, is always going to view war more of an art than a science, a system of expedience, he calls it. Now, the Prussian army was not all that highly regarded by other European armies. Most Europeans viewed the war as one in which a superior Austrian force was facing the Prussians, in part because the Prussians, their performance in Denmark had not gotten a great deal of attention, and also a sense that the army of Frederick the Great had lost its edge due to the fact that it simply had not fought a major war since 1815, whereas the Austrians, they may have lost the war in Italy, but at least they'd gotten some combat experience and had some, and they demonstrated some tactical ability from their subordinates. In contrast to the Austrian army, the Prussian army was well organized. They stationed each unit in the area from which it drew its reserves and conscripts, and conscription was more or less universal in Prussia. There are fewer exemptions, and so consequently, they drew from a well-educated population, in contrast to the Austrians, is relatively homogenous culturally in terms of language. The infantry was first rate. The cavalry and artillery was not quite as good as the Austrians, but the infantry was first rate. And again, like I said, the principle of universal mobilization was rigorously applied in Prussia, and they were equipped with a revolutionary new tool called the Dreyse needle gun, which provided a breech-loading rifle as opposed to the muzzle-loading rifle that the Austrians would have. And this would prove to be a source of significant advantage for the Prussian army. They also had a general staff system and a full system of educating officers and rotating between staff and line and demanding intellectual development program, the foremost product of which is the chief of the Prussian general staff, Helmut von Moltke, who was born in 1800, but despite being 66 and 4 years older than Benedict, is in pretty robust health when he takes command, while Benedict is suffering from ailments. Helmut von Moltke, unlike Benedict, had no direct experience with troop leadership, other than the brief time he spent in Turkey advising the Ottoman armies. Nonetheless, in 1857, in part because he was close to the Prussian royal family, he was appointed the Army Chief of Staff. And in June of 1866, the king issued orders de facto making the general staff the commander of the army that would fight fight Austria. Now, the beginning of the war, what happens is the Austrians decide that they don't like the Gastein Convention anymore in June of 1866. But even before then, the sense that war is inevitable as Prussia is developing its diplomatic, as Bismarck is undertaking his diplomatic offensive. The 21st of April, the Austrians begin to call up their reserves in preparation for a possible war against Prussia. King William of Prussia is reluctant to go to war. He views it as a brother's war, and thus it would be wrong to fight an aggressive war against the Austrians. And this is going to be a problem for Helmut von Moltke, because Helmut von Moltke recognizes that the great advantage of for the Prussian army will be if they can take the initiative. If they can take the initiative, that will give them a great advantage against the Austrians. So Helmut von Moltke wants to begin mobilization quicker, but he needs authorization from the king, and the king is very, very slow to provide it. Finally, on the 12th of May, the king authorizes Moltke to begin mobilizing, although not necessarily declare war, and Moltke begins deploying his forces on about a 275-mile-long front, looking around on the border between Prussia and Bohemia, which is the northern province of the Austrian-Hungarian Empire. Now, he's got three armies. The first army commanded by Prince Frederick Charles, who's in his mid-30s and is the son of the king. He's the nephew of the king. He commands the first army. The second army is commanded by Frederick William, who is the crown prince. They are mobilizing Silesia, whereas the first army under Frederick Charles is mobilizing in Lusatia. And Moltke expects Benedek, once he takes command, to advance into Bohemia and possibly try to undertake an offensive into either Silesia or directly on Berlin in combination with their allies, the Saxons, who declare, when they go to war, go in on the side of the Austrians. Benedek assumes command on the 27th of May and spends a lot of time organizing and mobilizing his forces while the diplomats lay the groundwork for war. Perhaps the most important event is on the 1st of June, 1866, when the Austrian foreign minister drops the Gastein Convention, and Wilhelm I agrees to Bismarck and Moltke's request to send forces into Holstein, which is the province of Schleswig-Holstein that the Austrians got. By doing so, they force the Austrian garrison to evacuate and go to Bohemia. And on 14th of June, Austria, in response to Prussia's move, asked the German Confederation to mobilize against and punish Prussia. Bismarck's deputy walks out of the German Confederation. On the 15th of June, Prussia declares war in Hanover and Saxony and sends troops into both provinces. Hanover falls relatively quickly. By the 29th of June, the Hanoverian king has laid down his arms. Saxony falls relatively quickly in the middle of June. Herbert von Bittenfeld's Elbe army of three divisions moves into Saxony, seizes the capital at Dresden, and forces the Saxon army to retreat into Bohemia. Bittenfeld then seizes passes in the Erzberg, which is the mountain range that separates Saxony, Silesia, Lusatia, and Bohemia. And this establishes the German initial deployment for the war. You've got the Second Army out there in Silesia, the First Army in Lusatia, and the Elbe Army coming in from Saxony. Now, as the outlines of the Prussian deployment became evident, military men in Europe thought this spelled doom for the Prussians because it violated the rule of war that had been laid out by Jomini most prominently, that you generally want to avoid fighting on exterior lines. It is better to have the interior line when fighting a foe because then you can shift forces back and forth and achieve advantages, as opposed to doing what Moltke is doing. He deploys his army initially on exterior lines, separated from each other, and lays the potential danger of being attacked and defeated in detail. But due to the advantage due to Prussia's superior planning and mobilization, this is neutralized, and Moltke issues orders on the 22nd of June. Having gotten authorization for Wilhelm to finally attack the Austrians, he sends orders to Charles and Wilhelm to begin marching into Bohemia and to seek a junction in the direction of the town of Gitchen, which you can see on the map right here. Now, if you look for Koniggratz on Google Maps, you will not find it. It is in the Czech Republic, and the towns now have Czech names. So the town of Koniggratz is now known as Radekralov. In the talk, I will use the German names, and for those of you who are offended by those who might be of Czech sympathies and would prefer to use the Czech names, I assure you that I will also butcher the German names in my pronunciation to keep it all even. The first Prussian forces crossed the border on the 22nd of June. The advance guard of these three forces, the Elbe Army, and the First Army are under the overall command of Frederick Charles, But as long as they're separated, Bittenfeld is going to command the Elbe Army separately. But the objective is to get these guys combined together. On the 23rd of June, you have the First Army advance towards Reichsberg. And the advance is relatively slow because in pushing through the mountains, both Bittenfeld and Frederick Charles decided to have their cavalry in the rear rather than the front. So once they clear the mountains and begin advancing, they've got very weak reconnaissance elements out front. So their initial advances are very, very slow and very, very tentative. But nonetheless, on the 25th and 26th of June, Frederick Charles's force is able to occupy Reichsberg. And on the 26th of June, they advance towards Turnau, which is on the Iser River. The Iser River is where Benedict initially plans to advance from Olmütz, then via Koniggratz up to the Iser River and make his defensive stand there to confront the First Army or perhaps counterattack the First Army and Elbe Army and defeat them. And so the Saxon Army, which is falling back from in front of Bittenfeld, gets orders to fall back to the Iser River because Benedek expected to come up there, link up, and there they will fight the decisive battle at an advantage, taking advantage of those interior lines. On the 26th of June, Herreworth has advance guard has its first combat with an Austrian brigade at Hohenwasser. And in this battle, you get the first of the battles along the on the frontiers, and what you're going to see, decisive, a significant advantage that Prussian forces have as a consequence of the needle gun, as evident as the casualty numbers that you see in these battles. On the 26th of June, Prince Albert's force, again, he's informed by Benedek to hold his position on the Iser River, and he holds a defensive position at Podol. And there, he fights a battle with the Germans, with the Prussians, I should say Germans, many of them are Germans on the Austrian side, against the Prussians. And the Battle of Podol, again, you get an engagement in which the Austrians suffer disproportionate casualties, and they are forced to fall back. And in addition, while fighting at Podol, the Crown Prince of Saxony, Crown Prince Albert, receives word from Benedict that Benedict will not be moving up to the Iser River, but instead receives orders to fall back in the direction of Gitchen towards Benedict's army. That Albert, despite putting up pretty stiff resistance against the forces of Frederick Charles, eventually decides to disengage and fall back, but has suffered significant casualties. And with this advance, that the Prussians begin pushing towards Gitchen, the Elbe Army and the First Army and the link up there. Meanwhile, to the east, the Prussian Second Army has to pass through the mountains, and they fight a series of engagements at Trautenau, Skalitz, and Suhr, and where they face significant resistance, and in fact, they suffer a tactical setback at one of these battles, at Trautenau. But when all the fighting is over, the Austrians have suffered such heavy casualties that they have no choice but to retreat from the field and fall back in the direction of Gitchen. Until finally, Benedict gives orders for them to fall back not towards Gitchen, but toward behind the Bistritz River to a series of hills north of the Elbe River, north of the town of Koniggratz. By the time he does this, Benedict has become very, very pessimistic about the prospects for success. He hears about the Second Army advancing toward him. He's seen his forces suffer significant casualties at these battles. And he sends a message to Franz Joseph, the Emperor of Austria, and advises him to make peace at any price. Catastrophe for the army is unavoidable. So obviously he's not in a very good mindset for this battle that's going to take place. Franz Joseph immediately replies and advises him that to conclude peace is impossible at this point. And an adjutant to Joseph tacks on to this message a question. How can one begin a retreat without losing a battle? And it's been argued by historians that Benedict saw this last little piece of the message as a challenge to him that you must fight a battle before you can even think about retreating. So Benedict conducts reconnaissance and concludes that he is going to fight behind the Bistritz River on the high grounds around the town of Klum and Lipa. On the 1st of July, Moltke reaches Gitchen and has a war council with the King Wilhelm I and Major Otto von Bismarck, who has accompanied the king to the battlefield, not as a chancellor, but wearing his major in the militia's uniform. So he can be in tune with the spirit of the time. The 2nd of July, they have the War Council, and in which the king argues for bringing together the 1st Army and 2nd Army at Gitchin, which was initially Moltke's plan to do that, to have them concentrate at Gitchin. But Moltke argues there'd be no point, since Benedict has fallen back behind the Biserritz toward the Elbe. There's no point concentrating our forces here. Instead, we should bring our forces together further south. And at this point, the assumption is that Benedict has fallen back behind the Elbe, and that the concentration shouldn't take place that far north. Moltke's advice is approved, and the decision is to hold off the concentration until they have more information about what Benedict's forces have done. That night, though, Frederick Charles's forces push south from Gitchin toward the Biserritz River. They conduct reconnaissances, and they learn that Benedict has concentrated his forces on the heights south of the Biserritz River, here on the battlefield of what's going to be called the Battle of Klum, Koniggratz, and also Sadowa. The basic topography of the area: you've got the main road from Koniggratz that goes up towards Gitchin, from which the Prussians are inevitably going to advance, the First Army is inevitably going to advance from. You've got Sadowa here, you've got the Biserritz River, which is not an American river. It's more kind of a creek. It's not much of an obstacle. But the high ground up here, especially around Klum and Lipa, provide commands the crossings of the main road here. So that is why Benedict chooses this for his initial position. Also in front, he's got the Swiftwood. It becomes known as the Swiftwood, which is, if you go to the battlefield up here on the heights of Klum, there's a big tower that enables you to orient yourself to the battlefield. And this is the view from Klum looking toward the Swiftwood right here. And this is the village of Sistowez. This picture right here, you can see the tower right here, is taken approximately from right here. So you're looking up toward the Austrian position around Lipa and Klum. Scale?
What's your mile? 10 miles.
You're about 7 miles north of Koniggratz.
Well, there's a whole distance, the whole map.
I see, 7 miles, I don't have a scale. I'm sorry about that, sir. Okay, and the picture here is taken from the Swiftwood looking up towards Klum, and here you can see the town of Klum, and you can see the tower right here on the battlefield. Okay? So that's the basic battlefield. Benedict's position, he spends 2 days conducting reconnaissances, and he's got about 240,000 men for the battle, versus the 135,000 men in the Prussian First Army and the Prussian Elbe Army combined. And he deploys his forces, is how Benedict deploys his forces. In the center, over watching the road, the crossing from Sadowa, he has 44,000 men and 134 guns, consisting of his 3rd Corps and his 10th Corps. On the left, positioned on high ground around Probelis and Prim, he has 40,000 men, 140 guns, the Saxon army commanded by Crown Prince Albert, and he's got the Austrian 8th Corps as well. To his right, his initial plan is to post the 2nd Corps and the 4th Corps, along with 176 guns, 55,000 men in all, on high ground running from Klum to Nedlitz. And the idea is they'll be in position to watch the northern flank. They've identified the 1st Prussian Army, the Elbe Army, but the 2nd Army they know has come through the mountains, but they're not really sure where it is. So the idea is to have these two corps, the 4th Corps, the 2nd Corps, on the high ground here to watch the northern flank. And that's basically Benedict's plan. Evidently, he didn't spell out exactly what his intention was, but it appears he planned to fight a defensive battle and then look for opportunities to possibly make a counteroffensive. In his rear reserve, he's got the 6th Corps, and he has got the 1st Corps, along with his 3 cavalry divisions back here in reserve, in case there are any problems that pop up anywhere. So all in all, it's a fairly solid plan. He's got an advantage in numbers initially, and that is evident when the battle begins, because on the morning of the 3rd of July, 1866, the Prussian 1st Army begins advancing. They drive the advanced Austrians out of the villages of Dube and Sadowa, and they fall back to the high ground around Lipa and Klum, overlooking the crossings of the Biserritz. The First Army gets across the Bistritz, but then they get pinned down by heavy Austrian artillery fired from the heights up at Klum and Lipa. And essentially they get across, but they get pinned down. The Elbe Army down here manages to get across the Bistritz River here. They are helped by the fact that it is raining, and when the Saxon advance forces try to burn the bridge, the rain puts it out. So the Saxons, the Elbe Army is able to get across, but Bittenfeld gets very, very nervous. And the reason he gets nervous is he gets concerned, because as the First Army starts getting pinned down here, he becomes concerned that the Austrians might launch a counterattack, drive the First Army back, and consequently leave him alone here on this river, on this side of the river, in a kind of a very precarious, unpleasant situation. So Bittenfeld is going to be very, very cautious about his advance toward the high ground here. And by around 10 o'clock in the morning, you've got a Prussian army that is in trouble. It is in trouble because the attack here is stalled here. The attack here is stalled. The one bright spot is that the 7th Prussian Division, commanded by Karl Franceschi, this guy here, who, like Moltke, has no command experience to speak of, but he has very important experience, and that he was the commander of the Prussian Army's historical section. So anybody's responsible for writing history, you know he's going to be a good guy, right? He advances over here to the village of Benetech. Now what happens is the guys over here, the commander of the Second Corps, Count Tassilio Festitix de Tolna, who commands the Fourth Corps, the Austrian Fourth Corps, from his position here, he sees higher ground at these two villages, Hornwez and Mazelwed. I told you I'd butcher these pronunciations. He sees higher ground here, okay? And some of you studied Gettysburg, right? Kind of like dance. I see higher ground. So I will go out and occupy this higher ground. They move out to occupy this higher ground, and this leads them to pivot to face to the west instead of face to the north. As they do so, the 7th Prussian Division is moving into the Swift Wood. And the initial advance, the Prussians are able to drive the Austrian forces in here and reach the end of the Swift Wood, which could create a potential problem for the position up here on the high ground here. So the 2nd Corps, the 4th Corps and the 2nd Corps get pushed into the Swift Wood. They enter the Swift Wood, which turns out to be a very, very, very good place to fight if you are able to fight in open order and have good rifles to do it with. And they're able to load lying down or kneeling, which the needle gun gives the Prussians the ability to do. It's not a very good place to fight if you are fighting with close order shock tactics and trying to close with a bayonet. And this place is going to tear apart these two Austrian corps. They are going to send approximately 59 battalions into this. Now, Festix, he arrives on the battlefield. After a little bit of the battle, he gets wounded by artillery shell, and command passes to Major General Anton von Molinari. And Molinari, he decides to attack into the Swift Wood, and keep attacking into the Swift Wood, and keep attacking into the Swift Wood. It almost becomes like a magnet for the 2nd and the 4th Corps to enter into this wood. Ultimately, they'll throw 59 battalions into it, and by the time they're done around noon, only about 12 will really still have combat effectiveness. They'll have committed all but 12 of their battalions. The rest have been suffered horrible casualties. Nonetheless, by taking these casualties, they push Benedek to fall back. They force Franceschi to fall back to the edge of the Swift Wood. You've got the Prussians pinned down here. The Prussians not making progress here. And many of Benedict's subordinates begin advocating, now is the time to launch a counterattack. Let's take this force, bring up the 6th and 1st Corps, which Benedict agrees to do, and let's launch a counterattack and defeat the Prussian forces. And around 12 o'clock by noon, the situation is getting desperate for the Prussians. So desperate that Franceschi, as he is watching his forces start to give way in the Swift Wood, despite having decimated a lot of Austrians, he says, it came to my mind, as we're in that situation, it came to my mind, the famous quote we'd always been taught in the Prussian army, what Wellington said at the Battle of at Waterloo in 1815, when his army was in desperate straits. Give me night, or give us Blücher, which was the Prussian army that was coming to hit the flank at Waterloo. Of course, there is a Blücher coming, and that is going to be the Second Army commanded by Frederick William, the Crown Prince, which begins its march that morning about 20 kilometers away. It begins its march between 0800 and 0900. And by about 1100, the Crown Prince himself and his staff reach a position where they can see the battlefield. And they can clearly see the engagement in the Swift Wood has rendered the Austrian right northern defenses somewhat weak and somewhat tattered. And Benedict has been thinking about making an attack, but finally when he starts to get evidence that the Crown Prince's army is on his way, a threat to his right flank, he gives orders to the 2nd and 4th Corps to try to pull back to their original position. As they're trying to pull back to the original position, this is when the Prussian 2nd Army arrives on the battlefield and begins driving forward. They first occupy the village of Horonois, and then they send forces in the Swift Wood. Franceschi renews his attack, and they begin driving the forces through the Swift Wood. They then push further in the direction of the road, with the spearhead being done by the first division of the 1st Guard Corps. Now, the commander of this division is a man by the name of Hiller von Gertingen. Ah, dang. Okay. Hiller, okay. He is the commander of the 1st Guard Corps' 1st Division. And he receives orders upon reaching the high ground here at Maslowitz to hold up and wait for the rest of the corps to arrive before doing anything. But he's an eager man, an ambitious man. He's also a man with an ancestor to live up to. His brigade, his father had actually commanded a brigade in Blücher's army at Waterloo. Okay. He gets the orders to hold up, and exercising initiative, much like these corps earlier had done, much to the sadness of the Austrian army, this division, the commander exercises initiative and orders an advance against the Austrian guns on Klum Heights. And this takes place around 1430. The gunners have a hard time seeing what the Prussians are doing because of battle smoke and the broken ground in front of the Klum Heights. And this enables Hiller's forces to advance on Klum. And because they advance in open order, they advance into Klum, and before the Hungarian forces that are there even know it, the Prussians they expect a compact line to come and advance at them. But in fact, Hiller's men basically do infiltrate into the town and defeat the Hungarians that are there. And then they begin pushing south toward Rosberitz, and the road, if they can seize this and hold this, they will have effectively cut off the rest of the Austrian forces. Benedek, now that he responds to the crisis, he orders the 1st and the 2nd Corps to launch a series of counterattacks that drive the Prussians who seize Rosberitz. They drive them back up to the heights of Klum. Part of the 1st Corps goes off and holds off Bittenfeld's army, which finally advances and breaks through the Saxon position of Probelis. And Benedek, by using these forces, is able to launch enough counterattacks up towards Klum to keep the Prussians up there. Enough attacks here to hold off the Elbe army, and Benedict orders his cavalry to launch a counterattack in this direction, because what's happened is, with the arrival of the 2nd Corps and their victory, the Austrians start pulling back, and Moltke authorizes Frederick Charles to advance and continue pushing forward. They seize Lipa, and they continue moving forward. The Austrians send back a cavalry charge, which is enough to drive back the Prussian cavalry. They get stopped by Prussian infantry, but these forces keep open the retreat route enough for 180,000 of the men that Benedict had commanded at the beginning of the day to escape, to get across the Elbe River and find some safety. But nonetheless, it is clearly a thorough and complete, it is a thorough defeat of the Austrian forces here at the Battle of Koniggratz. The fighting continues until around 9 o'clock in the evening. The Austrian rear guard, which is some, consists of some artillery and a brigade, managed to put up enough resistance to hold off a Prussian pursuit. And like I said, most of the Austrian forces are able to escape across the Elbe River. But they do so in extremely poor condition and continue falling back until they reach Olmütz, their original advancing port, the place where they advanced from. The Prussians seek to follow up their victory. They advance into Bohemia, further into Bohemia, in the direction of Vienna. But as they're doing so, a cholera outbreak begins to hit the Prussian army. In addition, Otto von Bismarck wants to put an end to the war. Helmuth von Moltke has visions, and the King of Prussia have visions of marching on Vienna, capturing Vienna, and fully conquering the Habsburgs. But Bismarck advises them to hold off and quickly make peace. In part because of the cholera epidemic that starts to hit the Prussian army. In addition, Bismarck is concerned about the strain that the war is placing on the Prussian treasury. In addition, he wants to give a lenient peace to the Austrians because a lenient peace, he hopes, will make lay that foundation for no future wars in the future. The Austrians are happy to make peace, in part because after 1859 they were broke, after 1864 they were broke, and after 1866 they were broke and their army got smashed here at Koniggratz. And finally, they've signed what's called the Peace of Prague. In this, Austria loses Venetia to France, which then promptly cedes Venetia to Italy. Now, during this war, the Italians had fought the Austrians in northern Italy. And the Austrians had actually beaten the Italians at the Battle of Custoza on the 24th of June. So the Austrians were not enthusiastic about the idea of directly handing over Venetia to the Italians themselves, because after all, they'd beaten the Italians. But in the peace, they handed over the French, and then the French are the ones who handed over the Italians, so the Austrians can say, hey, we didn't hand it over to people we beat. The Prussians annex Hanover, all of Schleswig-Holstein, Hesse Cassel, Hesse Darmstadt, Frankfurt, Nassau. They do not annex Saxony, Sachsen-Meiningen, or a number of other provinces. However, the Saxons get such a are levied such a heavy indemnity for the war that they and others will join the North German Confederation that Bismarck puts together to unify the northern German states, excluding Austria. And Austria is required by the peace to recognize the North German Confederation, the end of the old German Confederation, and the organization of the new German Confederation. In 1867, a year after this war, the Austrians are forced to sign a deal with the Hungarians to transform the Austrian Empire into the dual monarchy of Austria and Hungary. The victories also have the effect of sweeping away popular support for liberal parliamentarians in Prussia and affirming the power of the crown and Bismarck over security affairs and military affairs. The cost of the battle? Pretty decisive. The Austrians suffer 42,000 losses, of which 22,000 are prisoners. The Saxons, their allies, lose nearly 2,000, while the Prussians lose about 9,000 overall in the battle. The large number of prisoners attests to just how decisive the victory was. In many studies, it is often a case where students of the military history of the 19th century will look at the German staff system, look at the needle gun, the advantage that technology provided, look at the more homogeneous Prussian army and its better tactics, and to a certain extent presented Koniggratz as the natural, inevitable consequence of this. This decisive victory could not but have happened, given all the advantages that the Prussian army had. But again, in many ways, it was a near-run thing. At noon, the Austrian commander, Benedict, if he had had the will to follow the advice of his subordinates and try to launch a counterattack, might very well have won a decisive victory. And indeed, one officer at the end of the battle comes up to Bismarck, who is often viewed, the victory is often viewed as an inevitable result of Bismarck's great statesmanship. An officer comes up to Bismarck and congratulates him. And it says, "Your Excellency, you are now a great man. But if the Crown Prince had arrived too late, you would now be the greatest scoundrel in the world." Any questions that you might have? Thank you very much. Yes, sir. Question over here in the microphone. Oh, okay.
What lessons are to be learned from this battle?
Well, there's lessons to be learned from this battle. In what regard? In terms of military lessons, political lessons, operational lessons?
Major lessons that even though it occurred in 1866, there might be some lessons that we could learn today.
Well, one of the lessons...
Political, military, economic.
One of the lessons we really like at the staff college is the importance of educated staff officers. That's one big takeaway, okay? But again, the Prussians had developed a system of educating officers, of providing them with career paths, setting up a staff system, of developing their officers to be very, very effective at their job, both in staffs in terms of managing logistics, managing transportation, managing subsistence for the forces. The Prussians had developed a very professional officer corps. And the Austrians were a little bit less professional. And so there is a lesson to be learned there in education, the importance of educated officers. Another is the challenges of trying to command an army, develop tactics, develop organizational approaches in an army like the Austrian-Hungarian army, where you've got communication problems, you have, potential differences among the various nationalities. How you develop a common way of fighting, way of thinking, much less a complex one, when you've got this challenge of managing an army where there are so many different differences within it. So there's that one challenge when you've got a population like the Prussian population, where pretty much everybody's conscripted in the army, you've got a very good school system, so you're getting well-educated people in, they speak the same language, the units come from the same areas, they feel the tide of the pot. So the contrast between the culture of the Prussian army and the Austrian army, I don't know what lessons it gives you, but it certainly gives things to think about in terms of how militaries operate, how they're organized, and how they're raised today. Did that answer your question? And have a better gun is good, too. Okay.
Yeah. When Bismarck planned this strategy in this war against the Austrians, did he do it with the intent of unifying the German states, or did he want the territorial expansion? What was his, political intent at the end of the day for launching this battle?
Well, Bismarck's attitude towards politics is he's a pragmatist. Politics is the art of the possible. So he is taking situations, managing situations, seeing how they play out, and then try to play them to the best he can for Prussians. Does he have some kind of grand vision? We'll do this, and then do this, and then do this, and do this. No, because, contingency comes in, You assume it's not mathematics. If I add 1 to 3, I'll get 4. Once I get 4 to 7, plus 7, I'll get 11. And that eventually, this is how I get from 1 to 11, right? That's not, Bismarck is too smart and too pragmatic. And Moltke's the same way with strategy. He says strategy is a system of expedience. You try 1 and 4, see what the result is, and then see the situation, what you got to add with next. But in terms of having a grand vision, his general goal is to sustain the authority of the Prussian crown, okay? The monarchy, the Junker class, the Prussian elites in power, and he views a unified Germany driven by liberal Germany be a threat to that. So his objective is to drive the German unification process, not from the bottom up, but from the top down. And Austria is going to be the big obstacle. The Austrians have very little interest in German unification, because if German unification takes place, German unification can't take place under Austrian leadership, because they just have Does it become part of Austria-Hungary? Does it become an independent Germany? But there's too many problems for Austria in solving that problem. That's why the Confederation was fine. Austria was part of it, Prussia was part of it, and the Austrians liked that solution. But it stands in the way. The Confederation is always there as a potential vehicle for, you know, revolutionary liberals to drive Germany to unification. So the idea is have Prussia drive the train. Austria would be the great obstacle, so they don't want German unification. And so consequently, defeat Austria, neutralize them, become the power in but how that's going to be, how you get from here to there, pragmatically play it that way. And then in 1870, they take on the French, which will unify all Germans, because this is just the North German Confederation. Bavaria and many of the southern German states stay out of the North German Confederation. But once the chance comes to fight the French, well, Germans will always take a chance to fight the French. Okay. Yes, sir.
Didn't the Prussians have observers in our Civil War? And the Austrians, did they have observers? Because didn't we have breech-loading rifles in the Civil War at the end, in the North?
All these war, the American Civil War does see innovations in breech-loading rifles and things like that. But the needle gun had been standard issue for the Prussian army before the American Civil War. I think it was first used in the 1848-49 revolutions when they were trying to suppress revolutions inside of Germany. So the needle gun existed before the Civil War. There were some Prussians who observed the Civil War. There was one with Robert E. Lee's army, a couple with Robert E. Lee's army. But in terms of whether they were there to study and took notes from the American Civil War and went back and told, I mean, the war with Denmark took place in 1864. So the Prussians had that to study instead of the American Civil War. When the 1866 war comes along, you know, they beat the Austrians in seven weeks, and the United States can't beat the Confederacy, and the Confederacy can't beat the United States. Whatever happens, it takes 4 years. What are you going to study? The losers who can't get it done in 4 years, or the winners who can get it done, or yourself, the winner who gets it done in seven weeks, right? So there are observers, but the lessons of the Civil War are not something that the Europeans really embrace as something that's all that relevant to their situation.
That's basically just a thing of technological survival.
Mm-hmm. But understand, weapons tech, small arms technology had been pretty stable for 200 years prior to 1850, before the American Civil War. And with smoothbore weapons, limited range, and it was pretty stable. And so doctrine and tactics had been developed based on that. And okay, the weapons changed, but there's some things that haven't changed. I mean, the first big concern Prussians have when they get this needle gun, and they say, wow, we can fire 6 shots a minute. And of course, logisticians are, oh, now they can fire 6 shots a minute. We've got enough trouble getting enough ammunition that they can only fire 3 shots a minute, okay? The human anatomy, I mean, basic physical strength, the traditional number of rounds you carried was 40 to 60 rounds, because that was what a human being could physically carry with them, okay? And so now that he can, And then you made plans on having enough ammunition to fire, what, 3 shots a minute, 60 rounds to fire for 20 minutes. Now you're firing 6 rounds a minute. The big concern is you're going to shoot off all your ammunition and that they won't have fire discipline and they'll shoot. And so there's the concern about the weapons. Okay, the weapons provide an advantage, but how do we integrate it into our other systems and the limitations of those systems to make it possible to, you know, to get an advantage out of this weapon as opposed to we try this new weapon, and it leads us down a false path, and the other guys stick with the tried and true methods, and they defeat us. So, I mean, there are the questions of not just the weapon, but how is it going to be used? How is it going to be integrated in other aspects? And the logistics one's a big one. Wagons, railroads are great, but once the Prussian army leaves its railroads and begins its advance into Bohemia, then they've got to use the traditional methods of keeping their forces supplied. And these are large, moving cities. You know, 135,000 men in just the Elbe and First Army, probably somewhere around 85,000 or so in the Second Army. These are big moving cities. It's hard enough to keep a city of 85,000 people that doesn't move supplied. Keeping an army that's of 85,000 moving supply, that's a big logistical challenge. So, and now in addition to the challenge of feeding these guys, now we got to give them, what, twice as much ammunition? The animals aren't going to, you know, get big enough to do that. So there are all those concerns about it. Did that answer your question, or go way off on other tangents? Did both, right, okay. Yes, sir.
Yes, you've already spoken a little bit about France, but I was just wondering what while all this conflagration was going on, what was the position of some of the Western nations? You've hinted France was probably unhappy. How about the Netherlands and any of the other adjacent countries?
I'm looking at the Netherlands and Belgium. The French, of course, the French in 1859 had fought the war with the Austrians over Italy. And let me see, well, there was a, forget the province was, a Bismarck, I think Luxembourg was the issue, and Bismarck kind of hinted to Napoleon III that he would not have objections, I think it was Luxembourg, he would not have objections to Napoleon III making Luxembourg part of France. And of course, there was a long-standing rivalry between France and Austria, north of the mountains in southern Germany, south of the mountains in northern Italy. Now, the northern Italy thing had been settled, and Napoleon III sort of thought, okay, if they go to war for a while, war can't be over quickly. You know, if the war goes on for a while, France can, you know, watch and play and make its advantages. But they had a long-standing conflict with the Austrians over southern Germany. And the Prussians didn't seem to be a major threat until 1866. My God, everybody was surprised when the Prussians defeated the Austrians, not just beat them handily, but that they beat them at all. Because Austria had 35 million population, I think Prussia had 18. And the assumption going into the war was the Austrians had really good cavalry, really good artillery. They had fought in 1859. They're experienced. The Austrians should beat the Prussians. And when the Prussians win, people are surprised. And Napoleon III is one of those who figured it was okay to bet the Prussians because they wouldn't be a major threat, whereas the Austrians had always been. Did that answer your question? And the British, of course, had the relationship with the Prussian royal family in that the crown prince, Frederick Wilhelm, whose army arrives at Koniggratz, the second army, is married to the daughter of Queen Victoria. There's that family, long-standing relationship between the Prussian royal family, Prussia's government, and England and Great Britain because of their mutual antipathy towards France. So, you know, the British were, although there was a concern because one of the first things the Prussians did was they went into Hanover, invaded Hanover, and occupied it. And Hanover was the traditional home of British, you know, the British royal family had family there, but, you know, they were fine with the Prussians annexing Hanover because it was still stayed in the family.
Returning to the needle gun, I'm just curious because it doesn't sound like it's a self-contained metallic cartridge like the Sharps carbine was using. It sounds like more like it is a paper ball, powder cartridge.
Mm-hmm.
If it's only six shots per minute, it may be more rapid because it's in the breech, but it still sounds like a slow process if it's only six shots a minute.
But six is still better than three.
Yeah. Admittedly, but it doesn't
sound also because
like
you load the breech.
The revolution that the metallic cartridge with a self-contained primer brought about.
And there is also the advantage of because it's a breech loader, you can load it lying down, or you can load it. The Swiftwood, let me see, I've got my picture up here of the Swiftwood, what it looks like. That's it from the outside. I mean, you kind of see this is one of the monuments in the Swiftwood. And the terrain and the sort of the vegetation you see around it, that's very representative of the Swiftwood. Go to the first slide. Again, that's in the Swiftwood. That's in the Swiftwood. I mean, you kind of see what it's like. And if you can operate in open order as opposed to tightly dense bayonet columns, and you can load lying down, you're obviously going to have a big advantage. Also, in part because the smoke's going to rise up, and it's going to stay overhead in the trees, and it's going to obscure the Austrian ability to even see what they're doing. So it's an excellent place but it's throughout this campaign that the needle gun just inflicts so much greater casualties, in part because the way it interacts with the Austrian system. The Austrian system is tightly packed, bayonet, simple things for all the guys who can't talk to each other to do. They can at least figure out, get close together, and go in that direction with your bayonets. And of course, if you've got the needle gun, you can't ask for anything more than the enemy to attack you in column, and then you can just shoot them to pieces. Yes, sir.
Yes. What was the role of military intelligence during this war, both on the Prussian side as well as on the Austrian side?
That's an excellent question. Military intelligence. Neither side appears to have made very good use of their cavalry in these operations. For the most part, during the battle, the Prussians keep their cavalry in the rear area until the Austrians start falling back. Then they start bringing their cavalry up for the final decisive charge down the road. The Austrians keep theirs in reserve, sort of be part of the rapid response thing. In terms of general intelligence, they did have information that where the Prussian Second Army was coming, the First Army was coming, the Elbe Army was coming, and they made efforts to try to stop them from getting over through the passes in the mountains, but the engagements that took place were just that the Prussians had just such a decisive advantage. And so the Austrians had intelligence, but they had some sense of where the Prussian armies were coming from. They miscalculated the timing of the Second Army, and you can understand why they would do that. If it's a rainy morning, you're going to assume that the other guys are going to have a hard time getting to the battlefield, by which time you should have won the battle by then. You should have won the battle by noon, right? But again, there are those kind of miscalculations in terms of intelligence. You were going to add something, Bud?
Yeah, Ethan. I'd be interested in your take on the intellectual capacity of the Prussian general staff and its impact on the battle relative to that of the Austrians. Were they able to plan better, faster, think on their feet faster, more complete? In short, do they have an intellectual quality on their side that is not found on the other?
You know, in looking closely at the battle and how the battle develops, I have a real hard time seeing the battle being conducted in a way that an American Civil War battle wouldn't have been conducted. I mean, the staff system is, I think it's most important in the initial mobilization and operational planning, but once it gets to tactics, it seems to me that the officer corps is, the basic plan is to attack, directly on the heights. And the idea, Molka's idea, is to hold them on the heights, and then that will hold them in position until the Second Army comes down and can hit their flank. But in terms of the officers executing the attack, it's hard for me to see a great deal from the grand tactical standpoint of a battle being conducted, much differently from the way a Civil War general who didn't have that kind of academic background would have conducted the battle. I think it's clear that at the lower level, the ability to manage the more open order battles at the lower level, that undoubtedly was something that the staff system, the intellectual educational level, and it's not just the staff educational level, it's the general education level of the entire Prussian army due to their excellent school system. That undoubtedly attributes to why they perform better at the lower tactical level in the Swiftwood. I mean, giving up allowing guys to do what they're doing in the Swiftwood without having to exercise tight supervision over them the way the Austrians felt they had to, that undoubtedly is a product of an education system and an understanding that you had educated soldiers under you, educated officers around you, who you could believe understood their trade a little bit better, or profession. Yes, sir.
Well, you may have answered it somewhat, but didn't Moltke on his command and control structure put in a lot of flexibility as far as missions to the officers and their interpretation compared to the Austrians that were using almost Napoleonic, written orders and
inflexibility. Moltke finds himself having to keep a tight rein on Frederick Charles, because as the Second Army starts arriving on the battlefield from the north, Frederick Charles wants to say, okay, now I've been pinned down, now let me attack. And Moltke says, no, I don't want you to push them too hard, I just want you to engage them and hold the Austrians there so that they can come down from the north, from the southern, and so the Elbe Army can break through as well. But in terms of delegating authority, Moltke does give orders during the battle, and one of his is to try to tamp down the initiative of Frederick Charles, who, like any 35-year-old prince, wants to achieve some grand glory for himself on this one battlefield, because you never know if it's going to come again. But Moltke's got to sort of stand on him to let him know that, no, you're not going to be the decisive guy in the battle the crown prince is going to be. But what the crown prince is doing, Moltke's far enough away that he really can't exercise control over it anyway. So yeah, the attack on Klum, the attack on Harnack, those attacks are made by the lower level commanders on the ground. And again, Hiller makes his attack on his own initiative. And after he's killed during the battle, during the fight for Wilberforce and Klum, but you know, he exercises this initiative on the ground, and it's decisive for the battle. Now, whether he needed a system to say to himself, it's better if I attack now than attack later, maybe he would have made the decision without the great staff system doing it. But, you know, because many commanders have made that kind of sort of decision in that kind of situation, disobey orders, take initiative, seize an opportunity without having to go to the staffs, without having the Prussian staff system. And of course, sometimes they do it and they can at least a disaster without the Prussian system. So better to have the Prussian system, I think, say.
After the battle and after the land was redistributed, was the unification of Italy a consequence of this war?
The unification of Italy took place in 1861.
So they were already unified when
there was a consequence of the 1859 war. In the 1859 war, the French supported the Piedmontese against the Austrians, and the Piedmontese participated in the battle at Solferino. The Sardinian king, Victor Emmanuel II, is the Italian commander at that battle, and he's there going to become the king. And it's in part because Austria has been rendered financially, you know, wars are expensive, that they really, when Italy decides to unify, it's Piedmont that drives it with, you know, Victor Emmanuel being the king, that the Austrians really don't have, you know, they can't, I mean, they still occupy parts of Italy. I mean, Venetia still belongs to, Venice still belongs to, Austria, but the rest of Italy that's, you know, had previously been somewhat subject to their control feels free to declare their unification, and Austrians are kind of, okay, we're kind of stuck. And then the Austrians fight and then the Italians attack the Austrians while the Germans attack, and so Bismarck sees this as an opportunity, not because he has love for the Italians, but because it's an opportunity to advance his own goals. Come on, there's got to be more. I got plenty.
And we can clap, yeah, definitely.
Okay, thank you very much.